Coming along, everyone. Today, as you can see from the title of the talk, I'm going to talk about log aggregation and how we convince people to believe that it's actually a useful and valuable thing to do at your organisation. We're going to focus on spinning up an ELK demonstrator. I'm actually going to try and do a live demo for you. One of which is signing my own death warrant. We'll see how that goes. It didn't work quite properly last time. So there's a couple of assumptions that we make, that you can install VirtualBox for yourselves, and Vagrant and Git, because they're really simple to install, and I guess we make that assumption on a lot of cases. So a bit about me. My background is in operations and systems engineering, so Solaris and Linux and Cisco type stuff. With multi-skilled, high-performing teams, with a 24/7 operations focus. Most of my experience has been in the financial sector, but I've worked in logistics and a couple of other areas as well. So at Skelton and Thatcher, what we're doing is, there's this cloud thing that's come along. We're helping organisations with both teams and technology, and making the changes to prepare for continuous delivery, cloud migration, modern system, software systems development is the focus. So our recent work is across a number of sectors, and we've been working as infrastructure architects, doing consulting on metrics and monitoring, and continuous delivery. We've been providing workshops. What we're beginning to see is emerging patterns crossing industry sectors, and this is particularly prevalent around this topic of aggregated logging and its value and some of the things that it can help enable. So really, why are we here? We keep running into this guy who's scratching his head and going, why do aggregated logging? I don't believe it's worth the investment in my time or my budget. Well, aside from we believe that it's a really good thing, and we think that ELK and Vagrant are pretty cool, it's really about winning these skeptics over. So we probably need to understand what we're talking about, so we've got a common understanding, we define the starting point. Just have a quick look at this diagram here. Yes, I know it's hardly a Visio diagram, but some of the best diagrams are on the back of the flag packet. So we're talking about multiple systems sending one or more sets of log data, collecting them at a central location, storing in a database, and making them easily searchable. Now that bit is crucial. In a diagram, here you go, we've illustrated in red, there's an agent on each of the systems on the left, which is picking up the selected log file data and shipping it in to the collector in the center who's writing it to the database store there. Finally, we're looking through that data on a browser. You know, that is supposed to be a browser, but I'm not a graphic artist, there you go. So, in the context of this discussion, we better move on to this ELK thing. It's not one of these. Let's put some logs, some labels on the diagram. So you can see we label up where the agents lie and where the log stash component lies, and the Elasticsearch is labeled up here. And we're using Kibana to talk to Elasticsearch and draw the dashboard and draw the, make it all pretty, so to speak. So really, Elasticsearch, Logstash, and Kibana. This is about these components being in a stack, providing a centralized location where you can ingest log data. It's searchable via regex, and it looks nice, and it has a customizable user interface. It's funny, every time I've practiced this and done it on client sites, I can't say the word customizable when I'm speaking about that. So we're going to focus today on why aggregated logging is good, how to get a proof of concept demonstrator up and running very quickly, and what components are involved. So why are we going to do log aggregation? Some of the reasons we're pushing this point when we talk to customers, when we talk to everyone in the community. Picking on just three of these things, three of those things, there's lots of different reasons, but picking up just three things. Collaborative approach is really important. We want to enable feedback and enhance visibility across technical groups or different groups within the technology organisation, and this continual service improvement. So continual service improvement is something which we're really seeing as a common thing which is going missing in technology organisations. So to give you some context of why we're making such a fuss about aggregated logging and its value, I wanted to give you a bit of context. So I wrote a fairy tale. So
once upon a time.
Almost. There was a company of developers, Brave and True, who built their product and shipped it when due. Of their product, they were proud, but they soon realised it wouldn't work in the cloud. The long march to SaaS well underway, quite soon they asked, why does deployment take more than one day? So manual installs, no puppet, chef or dependency tree, a giant tarball was all the obstacle I could see. Maybe that rings a bell with some of you. Perhaps you get the gist of what we're talking about here. So this is really the reality. This is not a fairy tale, unfortunately. It's more like a nightmare. Based a bit more on reality, we're pushing this point on our experiences, where we're seeing the effect of little or no logging strategy in organisations. And these are particularly organisations where we've been helping to fix problems with teams, software infrastructure, and performance. Typically, they're running multi-layer, multi-service architectures, and there's a lot of release problems, and obviously a few others, which we'll see about. Multiple teams, there may be differences in the value, perceived value of development and operations in some of these organizations. We're running into this kind of problem, seen firsthand. Long deployment times, low release cadence, really a week to do a deployment isn't acceptable. And helping people to get out of that conundrum is one of the points of focus here. Some of those organisations have built one of these, which a few of you might be familiar with. So part of the why of tonight's talk is on using aggregated logging as a means to start unpicking that order stream to provide to build something a bit more organised. Typically, we're thinking from a development perspective about stuff like this, which application component, messaging streams and events, and we're thinking about how those might detail startup or anomalous behavior. And with logging to the same location can really help us with stuff like debugging or understanding interoperation of different components. And now looking at this from an operations perspective, in which I include all of your networks and infrastructure and systems people, in addition to anyone who defines an ops team as slightly to the edge of that who deal with customer output. We typically think of stuff like IIS and Nginx logs and Apache, maybe Cisco Router Linux logs or VMware. Again, looking at what that focus is about for ops, what can that bring us if we're logging all those things to the same location? With stuff like faster response times to diagnose what the root cause of problems are. That's a real benefit. Visibility of system-wide events is pretty key. And one of the things that is nice here is that we can tie up events on multiple different servers in one stream. So from an ops perspective, this is really valuable. Hopefully you can see from a development perspective, it's really valuable as well. Really, here is the most crucial part of where we see the value in aggregating logging. The holistic systems view, knowledge sharing and common tools, getting people together to use the same tool chain is really valuable. Enabling collaboration. It's these things, enabling collaboration, enabling visibility and CSI, continual service improvement again. I want to reiterate that point. It's about this. This is really all about having feedback from operations to development, development to operations, and getting that virtuous circle. Nicely brought together in Gene Kim's illustration, which many of you would have seen before. And the thing I like about this is the cyclical nature of the diagram, indicating multiple feedback loops. CSI, continual service improvement, is all about feedback loops. So let's look at how we're going to do this today. Demonstration, that is. We're going to use these components to build a simulation of an aggregated logging platform. This is the diagram we had earlier, just with the labels on. So we use Vagrant. There's loads of stuff about it here. Vagrant, you can look it up on the internet. It's enough to say it's awesome. Recapping the ELK stack, you probably have maybe got the gist of this bit by now. So let's look at what we're going to deliver. As a demonstrator, we're going to give you a fully set up Ubuntu box with all of the ELK components. And it's portable, it fits on my laptop. It's configured to listen to its own logs. It's also bundled. If you download, if you build it, you get a bundled log generator script, which, whilst it's trivial, it gives us something to hang on. This is an application log as a demonstration. And we'll have a little look at the user interface as well whilst we're running the demo. So we built it as well so that after the first run, it caches all the downloads. So you need to run it when you first start, and then as long as you don't remove the packages directory, you don't need to do any downloads again, meaning you can take it somewhere like here, switch your network interfaces off, and once you uncork it, it still works. So you can take it to the boss's office, or you can take it to the meeting room with the team, with the pizza, and everyone's filling their faces and not paying attention. But within a few minutes, you'll be able to get this up and running. If you want to demo it live from the net, just to show how cool Vagrant is, it takes about 5 minutes if you've got a good internet connection to download the packages. So that's just a general tracking bit. So the code, the config, and the scripts are available on GitHub. Here's the link. It's probably time that I risk my neck and do a demo. So let me just switch out. Can everyone see that at the back? Hopefully, it's massive.
Yep.
Okay. So this is a simple, once you've installed the prerequisites, VirtualBox, Vagrant, Git, and you've done Git clone to get our repo, pull it onto your local machine, it's as simple as typing Vagrant up in the directory, which has got the repo. So I'll just start that off and grab my notebook. Left around here. So just a quick, I'm going to give a very quick overview of what we've built in the repo. Otherwise you're going to get bored watching the screen spin. So, in the repository we've got a Vagrant file. Now a Vagrant file, for those of you that don't know, allows you to define the shape of the machine. So the number of virtual CPUs, the number of memory, the IP address, any port forwarding for network purposes that you want to set up, and it lets you configure the parameters that get stuffed into VirtualBox essentially, and it lets you configure things like how to do provisioning. One of the neat things that Vagrant provides us is the ability to use Chef or Puppet or even a shell script. So in our demonstration, we're using a shell script. Really simple, really easy to understand what's going on, and it's just declarative, so top down, passes down, and it does a few things to the box. It installs the cache packages, and it does some setup, so it configures, for example, a default dashboard, which you'll get to see in a minute. Otherwise, you point your web browser at the machine, and nothing happens. And usefully, it sets the time zone and corrects the clock, so that when we're looking for our logs, we don't go, hang on, time's wrong, there's no logs, wherever they've gone. Then we use some functionality. So we're probably nearly there. Sketch. One of the things that's actually quite useful about Vagrant is that you can plug it into both AWS and Azure. You don't want to do this on your local machines, you happen to have demo accounts, or you're using a work account that you want to get that you hit the tab up for. So the script finishes, and then there's a couple of lines there which are a bit more sensible to read if you're at the smaller font size. Now just the browser. So what we should have is the noise of my laptop fan spinning up like a hovercraft. Here we are. So this is the default dashboard that the script installs for you. Just a few words about that. So let's talk about the first part of the user interface. Top box on this default dashboard that we can install for doing regex searches. You can, everyone know what regex is, in asterisk, stars, bangs, etc. Underneath that, you've got a time series graph. So we've only just started this machine, so on the far right hand side, you can just see a couple of green bars. You can dive into the time scale of that graph by dragging and highlighting. Everyone see that I've just done that all there. That's a bit more useful view. So what we can see here is actually these will be the system startup log messages, which is a massive spike, followed by a few more, and then gradually we'll have log entries being provided by our sort of trivial log message generator script. That's bundled inside the repo, so you can customize that and put silly messages in if you want to. So if we just leave that with no filtering, scroll down. The second panel allows you to see the full text of all of the log messages which are coming in, and on the left hand side under fields you get default to the currently populated fields that are inside the logs that are being displayed. To make this a bit more readable, you might want to look at that. So we just filter it on timestamp message. So you can see there's a pretty easy to use configuration here. Now what appears in the main window is constrained to whatever events have occurred in the graph. So we can set that to be any number of different parameters. 5 minutes through to 30 days. You can have it to refresh if you have customizations. So if I type in star out, because I know what is coming through from the message generator script. Here we can see a message regarding the HAL AE35 unit. We just built this part of the demo so you can use this as an illustration of how you might look at a sequence of events from an application that is having its logs collected up. Again, we're limited in that there's only one machine and we're not ingesting logs from lots of different locations. There you go, so pretty straightforward. Sequential timestamp log entries. Okay, as everyone is completely fascinated with log entries, I'll then.
Are you sure about the different messages? And there were a number of same messages. Is there any permission to give the different distinct messages out of that?
Yep. So let's get back to it. So you want to see
the distinct method.
Let's clear some parameters. So if I want to see an individual message, I click on it, and this allows me to.
No, the distinct messages. So there were a number of messages over time. So instead of, I just want to see that how many times a single message occurred.
Oh.
And on from return, which also occurs.
You can use the scene syntax with the bond. So if the scene calls it, then you probably can.
Okay.
So what do you want to do? You want to count the number of individual messages of a particular type?
Yes.
I'm sure you can do that, but I haven't had that question thrown at me. So if anyone knows the answer to do that using the query box, then feel free to provide our compatriot there with some information.
You can curl to get pretty much any data that you want over that as well, so if you click that I. Basics of the query that's been together, so to sit on top of that query so I can pretty much query
because we were facing that issue that I was not able to get the different messages. Yeah, that makes sense.
I use Logstash and Kibana as well, and I find that Logstash uses not a lot of JVM memory.
Yeah.
So.
Log ship array.
So, what are you asking?
The question is that that's too much. It's way too much for just pushing on logs, right?
I don't know. I think it depends what environment you're working in. Memory is not considered.
Half gig is a lot.
Do you mean Logstash forwarder is using?
Yes. Yeah. Half gig is too much.
You talking about client?
Logstash forwarder is on GitHub.
Use log ship
array.
We're trying to avoid using Splunk, right? Just be on Splunk, right?
I'm not going to point my fingers at any particular.
So we have to instead very high memory use and CPU usage. Just really fine. No one thinks that.
There are alternative clients, so there's one with you go, there's one with Python called
Go one's good. Python one's here at all, but Go one is kind of okay. But again, it's not kind of prod, it's not fantastic either.
Okay. I think, so rather than getting particularly bogged down in specifics of a JVM memory usage or particular.
My kind of question is ultimately, if you are having to push logs and CPU and memory, how is that variable? How's that good and bad?
Well, the point I was going to make is if the tool is outside of your memory and CPU constraint boundaries for your production environment, your development QA, whatever environment, and there is another thing, then use the other thing. This, what I'm seeking to illustrate here is not actually that ELK should use every sentence.
I want to use this, but ultimately, in the last search, it says use 50% memory for us, right?
Right.
So in a way, it's like, wow, so I've got a server, just doing some work, and all of my logging, half it is already partitioned off, saying, it's going to be involved in just logging.
You could syslog it somewhere else, pick it up then.
Yeah, but then there's a bit more work, right? And also, same time, so I answer my script to one of the results. So answer does all of the complete and deployment. So you're pushing more, more on me to do stuff, as opposed to just saying, here we go, here's, apt-get install logstash, off you go, right? There's more push on me to do something.
You just need to look for your own alternatives.
Yeah.
Interesting, that's what's there, because obviously what you're saying is what you've got or what this gives you is not suitable for you, ultimately.
The point here is to use this as a tool to win the argument, the general argument about whether we should do aggregated logging or not.
Okay.
If you don't use ELK, it actually doesn't matter. It's more important that you win the argument about
So you know
what the benefits are to be.
Okay.
What we're saying is we're running into lots of people that are arguing that it's not worth the time. And this is really what the central thrust of the pitch is. As well as that, I don't work for Elasticsearch. you can demo the thing. So just a quick recap, there's a time series of events which you can drill into. There's all the goodness and what have you of the event details. You can select and do easy filtering. You click on any individual message, you can filter or not filter based on that. You can do regular expression searches. And that changes the main display to media regular expression as you would expect. So last couple of slides. What we've got here is a demo tool. That's the point, it's a demonstrator that we've used to convince developers and managers that actually it's worth going in and having that look at aggregated logging and implementing it in their architectures. And it's forced that sort of rethink of do we have a strategy around how we build our messages that come out of our applications. It could be as simple to get this up and running as these three commands, and sitting back, going for a cup of coffee or whatever you want, while waiting for your VM to spin up, and then you walk your laptop around to whoever you want to demonstrate it to. So just to round up and recap, the why is the important bit. It's about enabling collaboration, visibility, and the continual service improvement parts of the benefits here. So that's Mark's given me the 5 minute warning already. Probably ran over. That's about as much as I have to say for you guys this evening. And I'll be hanging around if you want to fire any particular questions at me, or if we've got time now, Mark.
One thing that you haven't, one other benefit you haven't mentioned in your aggregation is forensics.
Agreed. We just tried to keep it to three.
Yeah. But I mean, I cannot overstress the benefit of having aggregated logs. If you find a system that's gone down, and you may find that it's been malicious activity or simply some infrastructure failure.
Yeah.
But having aggregated logs that will aggregate the event for you, and you can see the whole thing as a gestalt in front of you, is a benefit you simply cannot overstress.
I think in support of that particular point, one of the discussions where I sat and talked about logging with a lead developer of the product who was not doing any centralized logging, was that in a half an hour session, he was able to see both his application logs and the Nginx server logs in one event stream. And so it was immediately won over to the idea that actually this is great because I can correlate when there are app layer problems and when there's loading or when there's additional messages coming through from the web server running. So in a support forensics, that's my illustration.
So I think most of us get it. In terms of the resistance, you said other people don't get it. What are the questions? Why do they not get it? What is the cost?
I think there's probably a variety of reasons, but they basically boil down to we're too busy, which is, have you guys seen the Lego men pulling the car with square wheels? We're too busy to fit tires or wheels to their car. It's that type of scenario. You don't need to prioritize. It's seen as an operational thing. Logging is not seen as a development activity. Not treated as a first-class concern in the organization.
So it's purely just we're too busy, it's not cost?
There's we're too busy. Cost is a part of that. We're too busy is a longer, it can take a number longer. So we're too busy to provide a cost justification. The PM doesn't want to pay for it. We're too busy doing features. Those types of arguments.
My number one motivator, I tell you, about centralized logging is you can't forensic your dead machine. If you have a log somewhere else, you can try and find out what happened. Mm-hmm. Have you had a chance to assess cross-fire versus give up there yet?
I think Matthew's used graphite for the previous incarnation.
That's it. And the last one, I have bad news for you. The future deployment is far off. Go check, because we'll do snapping.
But it's not the oxide, I only have the tarball and not knowing what to do. That's the critical difference, right? Okay, thanks very much.